GearNetwork.com.
The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network.
I believe it's a big challenge for our building to keep things in perspective and to if we're going to get addicted to anything, let's get addicted to the process.
And with that, we welcome you to Trust the Podcast, powered by Better Live Than Dead and the Gear Radio Network. This is episode 101.
Episode 101, my babies, here on this fine, beautifully fine, sexy Wednesday night, baby. That's my bad Dusty Rhodes voice.
I like how you did that. That was really good. It's the Buffalo Bills at the New England Patriots. As always, you know, I'm Ryan Wolfe at Wolfe BLTD. Joining me on the IndyCar Media Hotline is John Cimino at IMJC Money. And don't ever forget, you can always hear us on BetterLiveThanDead.com, GearNetwork.com, and wherever else you listen to podcasts. Make sure also to hit that subscribe button as well to stay up to date on all the latest podcasts. John?
Yes, sir.
A couple days after Christmas, man. How was your Christmas? How did everything go? Goodness.
Christmas is the Mecca, man. It is the Super Bowl in the Cimino household. The kids were happy. I was happy. I'm still listening to Christmas tunes because I know it's going to change over starting tomorrow. So I'm getting it all out of the way now. And then, but you know, it was fantastic, man. I already know the answer to this, but for the sake of the podcast, how was yours?
I appreciate that. It's day six of COVID protocol. I have not tested positive yet, but everybody around me at work has test positive. But I wear a mask and follow COVID protocol. So if this PCR test comes back positive or negative, I should say, which is what we want, then that will mean that wearing a mask, staying socially distant, getting vaccinated and boosted really does up your chances of not getting COVID, because three people around me have since tested positive for COVID in the last 6 days. So keep you posted on that one. Christmas was not great because I opened gifts over Google Duo with my wife and baby. I have not seen my wife and or baby. I mean, my wife drove up to the house earlier today and I was able to see her, but like, I can't physically like get close to her or the baby still until I test negative, because obviously we don't want that to happen or anything to happen there. But
right.
It's been challenging, but I've been trying to make the most of it. I appreciate both you and Lewis for kind of keeping me sane this last week.
We try our best. Hey, if it's any consolation, testing positive may not necessarily be a bad thing. I mean, look at Magic Johnson. He tested positive in the 90s. He's still around. Hey-o!
Jesus, it's already taken a turn.
End of the year jokes, Ryan.
It's good news, though, John. We got an action-packed podcast. I've been very much looking forward to this all week because in our rundown, the Buffalo Bills continue to claw their way back into the playoff picture with a 33-21 victory over New England last Sunday. Buffalo now 9-6 on the season. They moved to first in the AFC East. A couple of cool stats for you here, John. Buffalo becomes the first team to win in New England in consecutive seasons by 10-plus points since the Denver Broncos did it in 1995 and 1996, respectively. Also, Buffalo is the first team to win in New England in consecutive seasons since the 2005-06 Indianapolis Colts. So pretty cool stuff to mention on the heels of a very big Buffalo Bills win on Sunday.
Absolutely. Not very many teams can say that, you know, beating New England in consecutive seasons in New England. I mean, like you just said, the 2005-06 Colts were the last team to do that. I mean, that's quite a long time in between the two sessions there. I will tell you, you know, it was funny, and I know we'll get to it. I assume we'll get to it with the stats. I haven't really looked at the sheet, but there was one play that I thought was hysterical, and it kind of sums up like Pat's Nation, I think, in a way. On the tipped pass, the double tip into Micah Hyde's interception, when they showed the slow-mo replay of it, and they showed it's right after the second tip, you can see a fan in a Tom Brady jersey, in his Tom Brady's Patriots jersey still. He was there at the game. But you see the hand slowly move up from the waist position up to his head in the oh no position as Micah Hyde was catching the ball. And I thought that was the funniest freaking thing ever, because it's like, you know, Brady was 2 years ago, buddy. He's a buck now. He's Buccaneer Brady.
It's still hard to shake those feelings, because you're like, hey, I've seen this Patriots team a million times, obviously twice a year for the last however many years anybody who's listening has been a Bills fan. Mm-hmm. For me,
or it's been, Jets fan for that matter, yeah,
21 or 22 years now of Bills football for me that I can remember. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's a lot of losing to the New England Patriots. So anytime you get a victory, it feels good as a fan. But John, our three big things are action packed because Josh Allen, among others, did a lot of historical stuff on Sunday. So I'm just going to get started real quick here. First off, as always, our three big things here on the Trust the podcast are brought to you by puckluck.com, your one-stop resource for all your NHL sports betting action. The games are getting back. COVID protocols are changing. Games are starting to slowly leak back in and Puckluck is on top of it. They provide win percentages and score projections for each and every NHL game to tilt the ice in your favor. If you're not sure what to bet or just in a rut, Puckluck also provides expert picks to get the puck bouncing in your favor or your way. Mm-hmm. Puckluck.com is in no way affiliated with the National Hockey League, its teams, or the NHLPA. Puckluck.com provides data related to gambling and cannot guarantee the success of any suggested or related wagers. As always, please gamble responsibly. Now, John, I know when we started the podcast, we always talked about changing the three big things up, but the running down the offensive stats one, it seems to work out well, especially when the Buffalo Bills have a quarterback like Josh Allen, whom he creates a lot of stuff to talk about. So if you'll give me just a moment before I get to your thoughts about Josh Allen's performance on Sunday, let me just run down all of this information I have here. Josh Allen on Sunday against the New England Patriots, 30 of 47 for 314 passing yards with three touchdowns and 12 carries for 64 yards. Now, Sunday's game marked Allen's fifth career game with 300 plus passing yards and 50 plus rushing yards, moving him into sole possession of second all time, breaking a tie with Michael Vick and Russell Wilson. The all time record holder is Steve Young, who did that 8 times in his career. Also, Josh Allen becomes the first player in NFL history with 100 passing touchdowns and 20 rushing touchdowns in their first 4 seasons. This came after Allen recorded his 100th career touchdown pass to Stefon Diggs in the second quarter. Josh Allen also recorded his 350th completion of the season, becoming the first Bills quarterback with multiple 350 completion seasons as a Bill. You may remember or forget, Allen recorded a Bills record 396 completions last season in 2020. Allen also surpassed 4,000 passing yards for the season on Sunday, becoming the first Bills quarterback in franchise history to record multiple 4,000-plus passing yard seasons. Josh Allen now has 131 total touchdowns in his career, the second most in NFL history, behind only Dan Marino. And that's, I believe, in his first 4 seasons.
Yeah, I was gonna say there's plenty more people that have had more touchdowns than that.
Yeah, I missed that part, but that would make sense because the whole first 4 season gimmick that's going through. Dan Marino in his first 4 had 144 total touchdowns. Also, the last thing here about Josh Allen that just cracked me up. After the game, it was caught by the Athletic's Tim Graham. Josh Allen was talking to defensive lineman Harrison Phillips and was caught saying, quote, "I don't know who the fuck they thought I was, Harry." All across the board, a great day for Josh Allen. John, what are your thoughts about the quarterback?
I mean, you know, that's the Josh Allen that needs to appear, and he's appearing when he needs to now. And that's a good thing if you're a Bills fan, not so much if you're a Patriots fan. This is the Josh Allen. I don't know who, if they knew who the fuck I was, Josh Allen needs to be that Josh Allen throughout the remainder of the regular season, because even though they are now sitting in the AFC East at number one, you know, there's any given Sunday, my man, it could swing back in the Patriots' favor and they could go from number 3, I think, in the standings or number 4 in the standings and hosting a playoff game to visiting somebody. So they need to just keep that, you know, take this in stride. This was your win. This was a big win. You needed it. You got it. On to the next one. Keep doing the job. I am a fan of – I've always been, like, again, repeating previous podcasts. I've been on Josh Allen, the Josh Allen train since it started. So I'm happy to see Josh Allen get, you know, enhancing his game, coming through when he needs to, and then showing off the swag when he has to, and letting people know who he is. So I have no problem. I have no problem with him doing that. And as far as the historical stuff, I mean, that shows you a number of things. One, his talent, but two, also when you consider the fact over the, you know, entire history of the Buffalo Bills, He's the only one to record multiple 4,000 plus passing yards in a season. How the game has changed dramatically in over the course of time. Like, I can remember a time of Buffalo Bills football where it was, you know, almost kind of like a West Coast offense kind of with Kelly and them. But I mean, they also had Thurman Thomas. They were very, very good on the ground, and they didn't need to really hit 4,000 pass yards every single season or whatever. But the fact that you've got a guy that's doing it now, I mean, it shows you exactly where the game is going. It's almost like, I hate to say it like this, because 4,000 passing yards is such an accomplishment. I couldn't throw for 4,000 passing yards, but I almost feel like that particular stat is almost equivalent to what 1,000 rushing yards became in the early 2000s. Like, 1,000 rushing yards had you in the head of the line for the rushing title back in the day. Now, you know, it's kind of easy to, I mean, not easy, but, you know, you kind of see it a lot as athletes change and, you know, strength and conditioning changes and the game itself changes. You see 1,000-yard rushers quite a bit. I feel like we're getting there with passing.
I don't disagree. The game is definitely, as you mentioned, John, it has progressed toward a we've seen it's toward a passing league, which is why the Bills had to make a point to get a quarterback who could keep up with the field. I would agree about the 4,000 passing yards too, about it being kind of a low benchmark, but that's the thing too for the Bills to know that, hey, we can keep up with the best of them because we've got a quarterback who can do it and who has done it, which
right.
is great.
And historically, they haven't been able to do that without some kind of conditions, dare say.
Exactly.
Looking at Ryan Fitzpatrick, for example. You know Fitzpatrick, if he, I feel if Fitzpatrick had this Bills team around him, he could have been the first to have two consecutive 4,000 passing yards because, you know, he knows how to throw the ball, but he's not, but he's very, very prone to making mistakes. So yeah, Fitzpatrick might have been able to throw 4,000 yards, but it would have come at the cost of 20 interceptions.
Yeah.
And Josh Allen's not doing that, which is great. And it's different, especially to this new generation of Bills fans that are experiencing the winning euphoria for the first time ever in their lives.
When you mentioned the swagger too, that we saw it a few times where it looks like they had put the game in Josh's hands. And one thing that was mentioned on the broadcast that kind of stuck out to me was going into the half of the Tampa Bay game, the Bills had said that something, and I can't remember who it was specifically. It might have been Josh Allen himself that had told the broadcast crew in pregame meetings that something clicked in that halftime in Tampa Bay. Like, hey, we got to change this. We can do this. We're just as good, if not better, than this team is out there. And they've played. I mean, again, the Carolina game was boring as hell, but they still did their job.
And then they needed to do
exactly. They needed to win, and they did that. But it's something where it looks like this team is going back to essentially living and dying by Josh Allen, like we've talked about so many times this season, where, yes, they need to be able to run the ball, but they're not afraid to let Josh Allen run the ball. They're not afraid to let Josh Allen make mistakes. He went out. I remember two plays specifically where Josh Allen was performing shovel passes. He had a shovel pass touchdown to Dawson Knox. There was the one play where ran to his right, had, I think, three or four, maybe five guys surrounding him. He jumped up and threw across his body, which is something you never do. That is a no-no for mm-hmm. any quarterback. And he did it and made an incredible catch or incredible pass. That was a nice completion. And you just look back at yourself and you're like, I don't even know who this guy is sometimes, because every time you think you haven't figured out, he just does something else that's incredible. And that's kind of where I'm at with Josh Allen. We're like, look, take the training wheels off. You got to win the next two games. And then you're probably hosting a playoff game for sure if you win the next two games, which we'll talk about shortly. But Josh Allen on Sunday completely balled out and did exactly what he had to do. And speaking of another guy, John, who balled out and just completely exceeded expectations on Sunday was wide receiver Isaiah McKenzie, who's had an up and down season with the Buffalo Bills. It's been highly documented, but he set a career high in receptions and receiving yards. He had 11 catches for 125 yards. The 11 catches are tied for most by a Bill this season. Beasley did it against Washington, and his 125 receiving yards are the second most by a Bill this season. Stefon Diggs had a higher total at the Jets earlier in the year. Now, I mentioned Isaiah McKenzie in the same breath as Cole Beasley, who has been kind of a wart on the ass of the Buffalo Bills this season. He missed the game after testing positive for COVID. And on Sunday, ESPN's Chris Mortensen reported prior to the game that Beasley has been fined multiple times this season, with fines totaling about $100,000 for violating COVID protocols. Now, I mentioned this, Buffalo can cut Beasley in the offseason while only incurring a $1.5 million cap hit. With players like McKenzie and Gabe Davis, when he was not on the COVID list, playing well, do you think that plays toward Buffalo maybe moving on from Cole Beasley in the offseason? Again, this is totally speculation, because the one thing, John, that I did notice on Sunday was that it felt like the Bills' offense had a different dimension with Isaiah McKenzie playing the role of Cole Beasley, where they weren't afraid to run a jet sweep, or they weren't afraid to kind of think outside the box. Whereas with Cole Beasley, he does his job very well. Don't get me wrong. You know, the 5 yards, spin around, catch the ball, and then kind of get whatever you can get. That's great. But it seems like guys like Gabe Davis and Isaiah McKenzie add an extra dimension to the offense. Do you see Buffalo moving on from a guy like Beasley in the offseason, or do you think this is just going to be, you know, we're going to put it behind us and we'll move forward and go from there?
I mean, it could be a little from column A, a little from column B there. Like, I can see both sides of that argument. As far as the on-field product goes, you know, Cole Beasley is a good weapon, and he has very clearly good chemistry with Josh Allen. It's been displayed for the last season and a half now. I think what it's going to depend on is what is the visual projection that the Buffalo Bills, what do they care about more? Do they care about the on-field product? And, you know, if they have to care about the off-field product, they will. But if they don't, and they kind of let their players, you know, do them, as long as it doesn't impact them on the field, I can see Buffalo keeping Cole Beasley and just telling him, hey, dude, just lay off Twitter for 18 weeks. You know, if it's, you know, this is a distraction and Cole Beasley has gone straight up damn knucklehead in this entire experience with him on the COVID list, absolute knucklehead. If that's something that McDermott really doesn't care for and the Pegulas won't tolerate that, I could see them cutting him and taking it and just letting him go wherever the heck he's going to go, one of the Florida teams probably, but either way, the Bills are in a very fun position to be in, where Cole Beasley, if his head's on straight and he doesn't go knucklehead and he just plays ball, you know, between the lines where it counts, it's a compliment to have him on the field playing for the Buffalo Bills. But in the same, they have enough people and they have a system that's very clearly working, no matter who is lining up. I mean, you got Emmanuel Sanders playing lights out in Buffalo this year, and he's old. So I think they could go either way with it. If you're asking me my personal preference, I'd like to see him out of Buffalo. Be perfect.
I would agree. Yeah. I think it's the risk reward of is the on-field stuff outweighing the off-field stuff. I don't agree with 99% of the stuff he says or does off the field, but on the field, when he's, like you said, John, when he's playing well, it really helps the Bills offense. And
right.
It sucks because you have that identity crisis of being a fan, where you're like, okay, you know, I don't want to support this guy because I think he's terrible, but I love this team, or I follow this team, or whatever it may be. So it's kind of I don't agree with it, but I'm going to support the Bills and whatever they do. And
right.
I mean, there are a lot of people out there that will carry the water all day. And obviously you and I are not afraid to call stuff out because.
Right. And there's the, so, I mean, if I'm the coach and I'm sitting in McDermott's seat, do I care about his, you know, political views or his scientific views or whatever? No, I don't, honestly, I don't care about that any more than I care about Kyrie Irving. If I were sitting in the Brooklyn Nets office, believing the earth is flat, when you punch out, when you clock out and you're, you know, your own individual person off of work time, then, you know, you do whatever you do. I don't care. As long as it doesn't impact the on-field product or the on-court product in the case of in the example of the Brooklyn Nets, I personally wouldn't care. But if his off-the-clock antics and his off-the-field stuff starts to trickle in and affect his work, or affect the people around him, i.e. his teammates, his coaches, You know, never mind what the fans think, because the fans, you give them a smartphone and a login for Twitter, and they think everybody gives a shit about their opinions, no matter what. But if the off the clock, outside of work life comes in, and it impacts the team, it impacts the you know, playing time on the field, it becomes a distraction where you're not talking about game plans and you're not talking about, you know, what you did, how you did your job. You're instead answering questions about why did you post this on Twitter. That would be something for me as a coach. If I'm starting to see at my press conferences, I'm being more asked about one of my employees when they're off the clock versus when they're on the clock and what their contributions are going to be, then if I were in that position, I'd cut them loose just off the basis of that, not because of what he personally believes.
It's going to be interesting to see how he responds when he comes back. That's right. Because when he tests positive, he said some wild stuff, and it was just like,
yeah, it was out there. And again, you know, I hate when I see people like compare him to Aaron Rodgers and things like that. Like, you know, it's not the same thing. You know, when Aaron Rodgers, when he was, you know, he didn't get vaccinated, and he hoodwinked the freaking media. He didn't hoodwink his team. In the same, you know, Cole Beasley didn't hoodwink anybody. He was almost Colby Covington, like, open with everything about that, and nobody cared. But like his, you know, Aaron Rodgers' reason for not taking the vaccine was because he's allergic to the, you know, what's in the HNRA or MRA or something, whatever is in the vaccine. Like, he's allergic to it, so it's a medical reason. Okay, that's fine. Of course, it took him forever to finally say that, but cool. All right, I get it. Lay off the guy. But if you're saying in the manner that Cole Beasley's saying and acting in the way that Cole Beasley's doing, you know, just because I don't wanna, like, okay, dude, you know, there's a very, very fine line with respecting, with being respectful of other people's positions and being a complete douchebag about it. And Cole Beasley for the entire season has really been kind of a douchebag about it. And I would argue that his production on the field has in fact taken a hit because of the distraction. I think teammates are getting sick of his crap. I personally think the coaching is getting sick of his crap. And the fans are clearly sick of his crap. So,
yeah,
looking in from a Jets fan's perspective, you know, someone not 100% fully immersed in the culture of the Bills Mafia, like, dude's a freaking pain in the ass for you guys. And I think that, you know, given the fact that, you know, they could, it's only a $1.5 million cap hit to a franchise run by a billionaire. I mean, probably cut your losses at the end of the season. If it were me, I'd do that, but based purely on work reasons, not his personal ones.
Yeah. And I think that's what it'll end up coming down to is, you know, you have to look at the risk reward plus obviously however things develop as the season goes along, because you see a guy like Gabe Davis, you see a guy like Isaiah McKenzie add a dimension to the offense, and maybe that'll cut into his playing time. We'll see what happens. But looking to the second of the three big things here, the defense was incredible again on Sunday. They did allow 21 points, but again, they got the job done. Micah Hyde recorded two picks. It was his second career game with two interceptions, and his five interceptions on the season tie a career high, which he also had five interceptions in 2017. Defensive tackle Ed Oliver recorded one sack, moving him to 1.5 sacks total on the season. The Bills did struggle once again with Damien Harris. He had 18 carries for 103 yards and three touchdowns, but Mac Jones was only held to 14 of 32 passing for 145 yards and two interceptions. Buffalo was really able to use their early lead to pressure Jones into some inaccuracy and some quick decisions, a lot of overthrows or wide throws. Again, he really looked like a rookie on Sunday, which is what you would expect when he gets a little shook, because, again, we saw that happen with Josh Allen, where again, something they mentioned before the game, Josh Allen had said that he loves these big games now because he's learned how to be calm, and every game is another opportunity for him to prove to himself and everybody that he can be calm and keep his cool in these games. Because I remember back when he was even a few years ago getting a big game and you're like, how is he going to screw it up? Because he's going to get sacked and then throw the ball up for a pick six, or he's going to, you know, not throw the ball away and take a big sack on a second or third down type of stuff. But the defense also limited New England. This is a pretty cool stat, to only one third down conversion. They were 1 for 10. This is the second time this season that Buffalo has accomplished that feat. So again, in all aspects of the game on Sunday, the Buffalo Bills defense was extra fantastic. They were extravagant once more. And that's a lot of the reason why this team still stands where they do. I mean, again, the Bills have, and I'm going to mention this later in the podcast, I believe, yes, their point differential is fantastic. They're just losing close games. But that defense continues to do their job week in and week out, and the Buffalo Bills just have to capitalize and continue to make the most of the opportunities.
Right. They do. And it's, you know, they're not a bad team. We've discussed this ad nauseum, that they're not a bad team, that they're, you know, they weren't winning the games that they should have been winning, arguably, this year. Jacksonville, hello. But I mean, they're a good team, and as long as they're turning it up and turning out when they need to, I feel like they'll be okay, or at the very least competitive until the end. I don't know that I share the same feeling that this is the AFC representation in the Super Bowl this year, only because of how very close everything else seems to be, plus these super long streaks that, like, the teams like the Dolphins and the Chiefs have been on. Like, you never know. Like, Indy plays people tough too, although they just lost Carson Wentz to Uncle COVID. So their playoff, you know, lives hang in the balance there. But I'm not as comfortable saying I see the Buffalo Bills in the Super Bowl this year, only because I've seen things within the team that are suspect, like the offensive line, yep, the running game, mainly those two things. The defense is, you know, the defense is doing what the defense is doing, but, you know, in the same, if there's no offensive line and no running game, and Josh Allen has to be Superman every single time, eventually that's going to wear and tear, and that's going to harm the team in the long term.
I mean, I look at it this way. If they're getting hot, because obviously it always seems like every so often, obviously the best team wins, but you look like last year, you look at Tampa Bay, they went on a run, won the Super Bowl. I'm not saying that the Bills are the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, but you look at the season, there are two regular season games left, and then the wild card is 3 weeks away. You look at that and you say to yourself, if a team's going to get hot, John, any given Sunday, but if they're going to get hot, right now is the time to get hot, because you look at a team like the Patriots, they won 7 straight games and they've fallen on hard times. You look at the Colts, who continue to run roughshod throughout the league, every team that they play, but you wonder to yourself, and you can't control this because obviously there's no method to the madness or whatever. You could be hot from October to December, lose a few games, and then crush the playoffs. But we've seen it happen in the past, where teams can get hot in December and then ride it to a nice long playoff run. So that's my thought here, is that if they're going to get hot, this seems like the time to do it. So far, so good for the Buffalo Bills, both offensively and defensively.
Absolutely. I get you, to your point, your exact point. This is the time to get hot. This is the time to do it. I don't remember who do they have? Who do they have this week?
The Falcons.
They have the Falcons. That should be a very easy win for them. Should. And then they come home, finish out the season against the Jets, which for all intents and purposes should be a rest the starters kind of game for the Buffalo Bills.
If the Patriots win on Sunday, the Bills will be playing everybody in that Jets game, because it'll have to be a win to win the division and you're in type of thing.
And that's great, because your boy's going to be at that game at Highmark, baby.
Cheap plug. I like it.
Hell yeah. It's going to be dope. So well, hey, John, all you trust the podcast listeners that may be there at Highmark that day, if you see, I'm probably going to be the only dude wearing some kind of Jets gear, maybe. But if you see a dude wearing Jets gear with a mask on, because I'm wearing a mask, stop by, say hello. Take a picture. I'll give you a shout out on the podcast. Yeah,
get a beer. Get John a beer. He deserves it after the tough years that he's had as a Jets fan. But got some more stats coming up, some cool stories, some interesting information, John. As always, would you expect any less here?
Am I safe to scroll down in the note sheet now? Or
yeah, we could probably do that. Okay. I want to get your honest reaction here.
All right, I'll wait. You tell when we come back from the commercial. You tell me when to scroll down and look.
Okay, because there's a couple names in there. I know you're gonna mark out at. So I gotta
be careful here. All right, America.
We'll take a quick commercial break. Podcast. We'll take a quick commercial break, and we'll be back with more Trusted Podcast here on the Gear Radio Network. And we are back on Trust the Podcast. Third of the three big things this week, we are wrapping up. John, you can scroll down now. Okay. First off, a quick unfortunate injury update. Offensive lineman Ike Butker went down with a non-contact injury. Tore his Achilles tendon. He'll be out the remainder of the season. But despite the loss of Ike Butker on Sunday, John, the offensive line did not allow a sack in the game, which is huge for them. It's the first time that this has happened since I almost said Christmas, but October 31st. That's Halloween. They played the Dolphins. They didn't allow a sack that game either.
All right. Now,
the names I know you're going to mark out at Stefon Diggs and Dawson Knox, not those names. Each of those players, though, recorded a receiving touchdown on Sunday, giving each player 9 touchdowns on the season. Everybody, put your seatbelts on, get ready, pay attention to John for this one. Diggs and Knox are the first duo to record 9
touchdowns
in a single season. Since Eric Moulds recorded 10 touchdowns.
My boy.
And Pierce Price recorded 9 touchdowns in 2002.
Also, my boy. Eric Moulds and Pierce Price.
I knew those names, my man.
Those are legends. I don't care if they didn't win a Super Bowl or get to the playoffs or anything like that with Buffalo. Those guys are legends.
I would say that they are on the all drought team for sure.
I love those guys. I was such a big fan of those two.
I know that when I saw the names, I immediately said John is going to absolutely love this stat.
Hell yeah.
Also,
that's a great stat, and that's great company to be in.
Also, John, I don't know if you caught the game live on Sunday, but I'm sure you've seen the highlights since. Stefon Diggs had the moment of the season on Sunday because he got caught by a hot mic, which was great. After he caught a touchdown, he pointed at multiple Patriots fans and said, you, shut the fuck up. And it got caught on a hot mic broadcast around the world. And John, it really seems to me, I said this to my wife and to my dad and to my brother, it really seems like Stefon Diggs hates New England like he grew up in Buffalo as a fan of the Bills.
It's amazing. That's fantastic. I mean, people respect New England, but they also hate him too. So, but he, you know, when Diggs came here, you remember he was kind of disgruntled in Minnesota. They weren't going anywhere. He wanted more. Buffalo ended up getting the trade. He came here. He fully immersed himself in the culture, very similar to how Josh Allen did when he got here. Like, he absorbed Western New York and all of the, you know, nothingness that you can do pretty much during the winter. But, you know, in the same, just the culture of the organization, the culture of the fan base and the franchise, and knowing how far out it extends in the state of New York. You know what I mean? That's kind of the Mecca. And then when for everybody that says, yeah, the only team in New York. Yeah. Okay. We get that. It is factual and it's very true. Like, New York is the Mecca. When you think of New York State, when you think of New York, you think of, you know, New York City, but New York State is still the Mecca. It's like California. You know what I mean? It's, if you're big in New York, no matter where, eyes are going to be on you. And if you're doing things in this market on a team that has had such a long drought before, but had such dominant and you know, big names and success, you know, in its years prior, and they're finally getting back up there, and you're joining these names, these legendary names, for me, Eric Moulds, Pierce Price, but, you know, the other ones, Andre Reed and names like that, like, that's something. And that means something. And that, with, for as many times as this team has been, you know, hinted or threatened, I don't want to say threatened, but, like, you know, are they moving? Are they staying? Is Buffalo going to lose the Bills? Are they going to Toronto? Things like that. Like, fans have grown to really love and appreciate this team, like, even more than they did. And I feel like that translates on the onto the field when they score a touchdown or when they win, when they do good. Yeah. It's just like a huge love fest. And how could you not get caught up in that? So when you go to New England and you're getting boo, whatever. Yeah, I mean, I'd tell them to shut the fuck up too.
I mean, John, plus you being a Yankee fan and me being a Red Sox fan, we both know that Bostonians will say some dumb shit a lot.
Yes, we do. I mean, don't excuse New Yorkers, though. New Yorkers are dumb.
Well, yeah, but we're not paying attention to them right now. But yes, I also agree with that because Yankees fans and New Yorkers do say a lot of dumb shit. Bing bong.
Like a lot of dumb shit.
Who the president? Byron, you know? Stuff like that.
Like seriously, like New York City, Philadelphia, and Boston all have like the worst human beings.
They're just nasty people.
They're just nasty.
Yeah, I would agree with that one. Some other stats for you here, John, before we move on to our look ahead. Buffalo's 33 points on Sunday pushed Buffalo to 427 points scored on the season, which marks the second time in team history Buffalo has scored 400-plus points in back-to-back seasons. They did it in 1990 and 1991. Buffalo's league-leading point differential is now up to plus 163. Buffalo's win over New England also gives Buffalo a winning road record for the third straight year. They went 6-2 in both 2019 and 2020. This was an accomplishment last achieved by Buffalo when they had a winning road record in four straight seasons from 1990 to 1993. Now, here, out of all the stats I've given today, John, here is your stat of the day. Stat of the podcast, stat of episode 101, Buffalo Bills versus New England Patriots, or at New England Patriots, I'm sorry. The Buffalo Bills did not record a punt on Sunday for the fifth time in franchise history. This last occurred on October 25th, 2010, at the New York Jets in the Meadowlands. Now, the bigger stat here, it was the first time in Bill Belichick's 474 games as a head coach that his team did not force a punt. That is regular season and postseason. So Sunday, we saw something that never happened before.
Wow. I didn't even know that. And I must have zoned out during all the highlight shows or whatever, because that would be something that I would imagine have to be mentioned, if anything, at least by Chris Berman on NFL Primetime. I must have zoned out because that's an incredible freaking stat. Holy cow.
I saw that and was, because after the game, I was like, oh, that's funny. Matt Hack wants a picture with Josh Allen. They tweeted out the special teams group, Reed Ferguson, Matt Hack, and Tyler Bass with Josh Allen. They posted a picture with their hands up like a zero because they thought it was pretty funny. But then I saw the stat about Belichick and I was like, wow, that's impressive. I thought it was just regular season. And then they go, okay, not just the Patriots, like all of his jobs and in the postseason, it's never happened, which is absolutely crazy. Just to tell you how good the Bills offense was on Sunday.
Right.
Now our look ahead here, John, if the season ended today, I know you love it. We're getting closer to the season ending today. Buffalo, the 4 seed, would host Indianapolis, the 5 seed, in an AFC wildcard game. According to the New York Times playoff predictor, Buffalo's chances of making the playoffs are currently at 97% without any help. A win on Sunday against Atlanta would boost those chances to 99%, again, without any help. A loss would drop Buffalo to 91% without any help. So again, do your job, win the game, and you'll be good to go into week 18.
And it feels like that's pretty much where we're going to be.
Sure.
Like I said, I don't anticipate, unless, like you said, the Patriots win, I don't anticipate seeing much of Josh Allen, if any at all, when I go there on the 9th. I'll see a lot of Zach Wilson because but the Josh Allen and Stefon Diggs and all that, I'll still yell and scream. I'll be like, Josh, I've been putting you over in the podcast. Trust the podcast. And he's going to look at me and flip me off and tell me, shut up.
He's going to be like, I'm sorry. What is your problem, sir? He'll be like,
hey, Stefon, can you do that thing you did in New England? And he'll look at me and go, hey, shut the fuck up. I'll be like, all right.
Well, rolling into week 17 of the NFL season, the Buffalo Bills host the Atlanta Falcons. The Falcons are 7-8, third in the NFC South. I believe they are still actually active in the NFC playoff wildcard hunt. They defeated the Detroit Lions 20-16 last Sunday. Looking across the board right now, Matt Ryan, Atlanta quarterback, he has 3,555 passing yards, 19 touchdowns, and 11 interceptions. The two players the Buffalo Bills are going to need to keep their eyes on Sunday. First off, Atlanta running back and wide receiver Cordarrelle Patterson. He has 140 rushing attempts on 579 rushing yards with six rushing touchdowns and 49 receptions for 523 yards and five receiving touchdowns. He's a dual threat. He's had a couple down games lately. Scoring touchdowns has really helped out his case in fantasy. But he's had a couple down games recently, so maybe that will continue against the Bills. But we know how much they struggle with dynamic running backs. Also, Atlanta tight end Kyle Pitts, who really is like a wide receiver, but they call him a tight end. 64 receptions on 101 targets, 949 yards, and only one touchdown. A big note as well from the Buffalo Bills on Wednesday morning, wide receiver Cole Beasley, wide receiver Gabe Davis, offensive lineman John Feliciano, and defensive end AJ Epinesa, all activated from the reserve COVID-19 list. So they will be back most likely on Sunday for the Buffalo Bills. John, real quick, what do you think is going to happen on Sunday for the Buffalo Bills? What's your prediction here?
I think it's going to be, I think it'll be competitive probably for like the first quarter and a half. I wouldn't be surprised to see the Bills start to run away with the game though, after the halftime. I don't know that it's going to be a complete runaway because again, with the Cordarrelle Patterson factor, versus, you know, the Bills and their run defense, which is pretty terrible, to be honest with you. Cordarrelle I'll tell you what, I'm a fan of the guy because of a lot of his off the field stuff. Like he's genuinely a good dude, but also he gets it. He's like, you know, well, what did he say when he was asked earlier this season about playing the dual role position? Like, don't you want to just be a wide receiver or just a running back or whatever? And he said, my mom had to work a number of different positions in her job. Why would I complain about having to do that with me?
He's a great guy.
He's extended his career too. Yes, he has. He gets it. He plays hard. He plays well, despite his down. I mean, he plays in Atlanta, so a down game here and there is to be expected. But with that being said, I see this as a Bills victory. I'm going to go, let's see, I'll keep it in the 30s for the Bills. So we'll say 34-17. Buffalo. I think it'll be a rather easy game for them. Not physically easy, but easy.
I think for me, you look at Cordarrelle Patterson, I think that's the big worry for me as a Bills fan, is just looking at this game because of how dynamic he is. You really see like what they're doing in Atlanta, they've started doing in San Francisco with Deebo Samuel, which is working out very well too. You have a guy who can
They're on a streak. Talking about teams that were on a streak earlier on, they're on one too.
Well, now they got a quarterback with a torn up thumb and a broken thumb. So that's not good, but
yeah. Crazy, man.
I'm just going to say here, because again, John, to quote the great Michael Scott, I'm not superstitious, but I am a little stitious. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to go with what I said last week. Just win the football game. Doesn't matter how pretty, how ugly. At the end of the day, make sure when that clock hits, triple zeros at the end of the fourth quarter that you are the victor, because at that point you continue to put pressure on everybody else, but you also guarantee that you're at least going to make the playoffs in some fashion. My thought would be, because we've seen some upsets, we've seen some crazy stuff happen. I mean, the Cardinals have fallen on hard times. The Chargers lost to the Texans recently. We've seen a few of those games where you're just like, how did that happen? But really, John, as you've mentioned so many times in the podcast, this season really has been the true definition of any given Sunday. Anybody can win. You're equals when you stand on the field and then just find out who wins at the end of the game. And a lot more times than not, we've been surprised.
Absolutely. And you know, you're over here quoting people. I'm going to go ahead and say a quote from someone else. And let's see if you remember this one or know who I'm talking about here. But when you score a touchdown, you get 6 points. If you score more touchdowns than the other team, you win the game.
The great John Madden.
Yes, sir.
The great John Madden, who recently passed away. Rest in peace, John Madden.
Yes. Yes, that's what I'm going to say. You got one guy going boom, one guy going whack, and one guy not getting in the end zone.
That's
going to happen for the Falcons. They're not going to get in the end zone. The Buffalo Bills will.
I didn't catch a lot of John Madden because I was kind of on the tail end when I started to watch football. I caught a little of John Madden, but I saw a clip last night where they had three water containers or Gatorade containers. There were two together and one apart. And I said, here's the mom container. Here's the father container. And here's the baby container. And I'm like, man, football used to be so weird. I love it. Yeah. I love it.
Yes, yes, yes.
Because now they're calling out plays and stuff. Like Tony Romo's out there analyzing the game like he's a coach, and it's great to watch. But you, then you got John Madden who used to be like, well, when you take one water bottle and you take another water bottle, they have a baby water bottle. You're like,
That's why all the commentators nowadays, why you see so much feedback like on social media about commentators these days being whack, because John Madden just set the bar so incredibly high for color analysts in football that it's just it's an unreachable bar.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I agree with that one. So, John, with that being said, we can wrap this bad boy up. The last Trust the Podcast of the 2021 calendar year. I am Ryan Wolfe at Wolfe BLTD. John is at I am JC Money.
I almost
messed that up because my brain was like, wait, which Twitter handle is it?
Dude, I haven't had that old one in 2 years now.
You'd be surprised how random stuff will pop up in my head. And I'm like, oh, yeah, that's right. And then you yell at me and I don't want to get yelled at on the podcast. but with that being said, have a safe and happy new year. Hopefully by the time you listen to this, because John, I failed to mention this, but I feel like this week between Christmas and New Year's is like the taint of the holidays. You know,
it really is. It really freaking is.
So
that is the best way to go out on this podcast.
I think we're getting more towards the butthole of the week. So happy New Year, safe and happy New Year, and we'll catch you in 2022. As always, John, thanks for joining me. Everybody, thanks for tuning in. And we are Trust the Podcast.
You're not.
As always, thanks for tuning in again, and go Bills.
Don't be knuckleheads during your New Year's celebration. Call an Uber or a Lyft.
The preceding presentation has been brought to you by the Gear Network.